Welcome, my dear students. So we have a new lecture on functional analysis. In this lecture, we deal with finite dimensional normed space and subspaces. So already we have discussed about normed spaces and its completion and its incompletion. So there are normed spaces which are complete and there are normed spaces which are incomplete. So now the question is, can you characterize these complete or incomplete normed spaces with respect to any set of parameters? So is there any condition which makes the space into a complete space? Or is there any condition or is there any particular criteria for which a class of spaces becomes complete or incomplete? So that's what our objective is. So our objective is to obtain a certain criteria or a certain condition which makes a class of normed spaces with that set of condition to be complete or incomplete. That's our objective. So the important observation which we will be obtaining in this section will be every finite dimensional subspace of a normed space is always complete. This is what we are going to prove in this section. So the major criteria for a space to become a complete space should be finite dimensional. Okay. That's what we are going to establish in this section majorly. Okay, so with that intuition, we will proceed. We have to use certain results to establish our condition. So one of the results will be this theorem, which is stated as that x1, x2, etc., xn be a linearly independent set of vectors in a normed space X of any dimension. Dimension is not given. So it is a finite dimensional normed space. Finite dimensional normed space means every normed space is a vector space. So actually it's a finite dimensional vector space, and every finite dimensional vector space has a linearly independent set of vectors which is called the basis. So it is actually somewhat a basis, x1, x2, etc., xn. It's a linearly independent set of vectors. And then there is a real number c greater than 0, positive real number, such that for every choice of scalars alpha 1, alpha 2, etc., alpha n, we have the linear combination, that is alpha 1 x1 plus alpha 2 x2 plus etc. alpha n xn is greater than or equal to c into modulus of alpha 1 plus modulus of alpha 2 plus etc. modulus of alpha n. So it is, well, what this theorem establishes is the fact that if you are given with a finite dimensional normed space with a linearly independent set x1, x2, etc., xn, then we can always find the scalar c such that the linear combination, of the given linearly independent set of vectors should be greater than or equal to a constant into the constant which we have mod sum of the modulus of the constant which we have used to produce the linear combination. So it is greater than c into modulus of alpha 1 plus modulus of alpha 2, etc., modulus of alpha n. So this is what we will be establishing. So let's move on to the proof. So first we consider a number s to be the right hand side of this path, that is modulus of alpha 1 plus modulus of alpha 2 plus etc. modulus of alpha n. So these are n distinct constants. So we consider two different cases. If s is equal to 0, then this right hand side should be equal to 0. So s is this thing. This is actually s. So s is equal to 0 means this right hand side is 0. We already know that norm of anything is always greater than or equal to 0. So which is trivial. So when s is equal to 0, the result is trivial. We have nothing to prove. Okay, so that case is trivial. Now we consider that S is greater than 0. Since it is modulus, either S is equal to 0 or S should be greater than 0. Then we write our constant as, we have to prove that norm of alpha 1 x1 plus etc. norm of alpha n xn is greater than or equal to c into s. If you move this s onto the left hand side, what we get is, which is equal to 1 by s into norm of alpha 1 x1 plus etc. alpha n xn is greater than or equal to c. This is what we have to prove for any c greater than or equal to 0. So s is actually a positive constant. Okay, so modulus of s and s are always same. So you can actually insert this 1 by s onto the inside part of this, because we already know that norm of alpha by s x should be equal to 1 by mod s into norm of alpha s. This is, we have already proved that since s is positive, which can be written as 1 by s into norm alpha x. So if you take the reverse part, 1 by s into norm alpha x can be written as norm of alpha by s in x, s into x. So you can write it as inserting 1 by s onto the inside part. We already know that s is greater than 0, so modulus of s is not enough, it is not needed actually. So it can be written as modulus of alpha 1 by s x1 plus alpha 2 by s x2 plus etc. alpha n by s xn greater than or equal to c. This is what we have to prove. So for convenience, I take this alpha I by s as beta I. Okay, so for I varies from 1, 2, 3, etc. n. So what we have to prove is, we have to prove that norm of beta 1 x1 plus etc. beta n xn should be greater than or equal to c. Okay, so this is what we have to prove. And also modulus of beta 1 plus modulus of beta 2 plus etc. modulus of beta n should be equal to, modulus of beta 1 is modulus of alpha 1 by s. Since s is positive, we don't need the modulus, plus modulus of alpha 2 by s plus etc. plus modulus of alpha n by s. So denominator is same. So by adding the numerator, we get this modulus of alpha 1 plus modulus of alpha 2 plus etc. modulus of alpha n by whole divided by s. So the numerator is actually s. So the answer becomes s by s, which is equal to 1. So what we get is, so we have renamed our constant alpha I by s as beta I. We can clearly understand that summation I is equal to 1 to n modulus of beta I should be equal to 1. So this is what we have established. Okay. So in order to prove that, we have to prove that for s is greater than 0, we have to prove that this thing is true, this part is true. For that, it is enough to prove that modulus of beta 1 x1 plus etc. modulus of beta n xn is greater than or equal to c, where summation I is equal to 1 to n modulus of beta I is 1. This is what we have to prove. Okay, so this is what we have to prove. Okay, so this is the thing which we have to prove. So if we are given with n constants beta 1, beta 2, etc., beta n, with summation is equal to 1 to n modulus of beta I is equal to 1, we have to prove that there exists a constant c greater than 0 such that this modulus of this summation is greater than or equal to c, which is what we have to prove. So we assume that this is not true. So We assume that it's not true. So what does that mean? This is not true. What does that mean? So if you are given with any set of n constants, beta 1, beta 2, etc., beta n, then for any given c, for any given particular c, this cannot be greater than or equal to c. So it should be always less than or equal to c. So it is not true means that for any given beta 1, beta 2, etc., beta n, this cannot be possible with the summation I is equal to 1, 2 and beta I is equal to 1. This cannot be possible. So this greater than or equal to is not possible. It should be less than or equal to c for all c. Okay, so this is what we have been assuming. So this part is not true means this is true. Okay, so this is actually so while proceeding like this, at a certain point we will prove that there exists some sort of contradiction, which is what our objective is. Then our assumption should be wrong, then this should be true, which means that the result should be true. This is what we are going to do. So we have assumed that contrary to our result is true, that is, for any given set of constants beta 1, beta 2, etc., beta n, with summation I is equal to 1 to n, modulus of beta I is equal to 1, for any constant c which is greater than 0, this sum is should always be less than c. Okay. So if we take, so this is true for any given set of constants, any given set of constants. So I choose arbitrary set of constants. So if you name this, if you name this as some yi, this summation as some yi, so ym. So actually, if you define something, some term called ym, which is defined as beta 1m x1 etc. beta nm xn, then beta 1m, beta 2m, etc., beta nm are constants. Beta 1m, etc., beta nm are constants. Okay, and corresponding to those constants, and for any given c, by our assumption, this summation should be less than or equal to c. So, what we get is norm of ym minus 0 should be less than or equal to c for any c greater than 0. So if you can choose this c as some epsilon, this means that norm of ym minus 0 should be less than or equal to c, which means that ym converges to 0 as m tends to infinity. I can choose such a sequence because we have assumed that for any given set of constants, this result is true. So I can choose arbitrary set of constants, and corresponding to arbitrary set of constants, I can define y1, y2, etc., yn. And because of this result, I can term this term as ym by choosing arbitrary set of sequences. So it actually means that ym minus 0 is less than some epsilon, which means that ym is tends to 0 as m tends to infinity. Okay, so m becomes larger, this should be less than c. This is what the basic thing. By our assumption, we can clearly understand that there exists a sequence ym such that ym converges to 0. Or in other words, if this linear combination can be termed as a sequence, all those sequences should converge to 0. This is what we can easily assume here. Please understand that summation I is equal to 1 to n, modulus of beta I m should be equal to 1. So we have summation I is equal to 1 to n, modulus of beta I m should be equal to 1 by this assumption. This is what our assumption is. Okay. So rest of the proof will be continued in the next video.